Dr. Bhaskar, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Anna University, Chennai. Area of specialization is Software Engineering and Database System. Guided more than 12 research scholars, published more than 40 national and international papers. He is a reviewer and editorial board member in international journals.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series in Computer Science. In this series of lectures, we have been looking at a course titled Software Engineering. And in Software Engineering, this session I will be including software testing, which will be the continuation from the previous discussions. The major contents of this particular session includes decision tree based testing, cyclomatic complexity and basis path flow testing. As I have told you in the previous session, decision tables are useful for describing situations in which a number of combinations of actions are taken under various sets of conditions. Decision tables have been used to represent and analyze complex logical relationships since early 1960s. We would like to show that how these may be applied to the testing and how tester may adopt the principles to his or her own situation. Consider this as an example of a decision tree table based testing, where initially we will have a condition stub and an action stub and some of the entrants. So, these three are the major deciding blocks for a decision tree table based testing, where in the condition stub I will be giving you different conditions, say C1, C2, C3, which majorly come under a class of either true or false. Likewise, for C2, within a class of true, I will have a true or false, and within a class of false, I will have a true or false. And C3, within a class of true or false, and false, true or false, for true or false, and false, for something like that. This is basically referred to as a confusion matrix. And what are the various set of actions which are considered as part of these specific conditions have been taken out as A1, A2, A3, A4, and the corresponding cross would indicate whether this would come under that particular condition or not. As I have told you, there are four portions of a decision table, namely condition stub, action stub, condition entry and action entry. When the condition C1, C2 and C3 are all true, actions A1 and A2 occur. When condition C1 and C2 are true and C3 is false, actions A1 and A3 occur. The decision tables in which all the entries are binary are called limited entry decision tables. If conditions are allowed to have several values, the resulting tables are called extended entry decision table. To identify the test cases with decision tables, we interpret conditions as inputs and actions as outputs. Sometimes conditions end up referring to equivalence classes of inputs and actions refer to major functional processing portions of the item being tested. The rules are then interpreted as test cases. Because the decision table can be mechanically be forced to be completed. We know we have a comprehensive set of test cases. There are several techniques that procedure decisions tables that are most useful to the testers. As an example, the common decision that we have considered for the previous session was on a plotting of a triangle. Say in that particular base, if you could recall, I have given three different values as A, B and C, for which I wanted you to check whether A, B and C will become a part of a triangle. So, for this constraint, let me initially take the same table confusion matrix, where the condition has been mentioned as X, Y, Z instead of A, B, C are the sides of a triangle. I might come out with an answer of yes or no type instead of true and false. If it is said to be no, then my action says it is not a triangle at all. Then I am going for second set of constraint where whether x is equal to y. This is another condition, and condition 3 is x is equal to z. Condition 4 is y is equal to z, for which I might have my questions on these portions. So, my answers for all of this lies within this for conditions C2, C3, C4, and this is only for the condition C1. By looking at a specific condition of x is equal to y, x is equal to z and y is equal to z, what is the conclusion that I get? Say on such case, I will say this could be a equilateral triangle. Without mentioning an angle, we will not be able to specify whether it is an equivalent triangle, but then if all the sides are equal, maybe I can come to a conclusion of saying this could be a equilateral triangle. Likewise, depending on the various constraints having given, I can plot up what type of triangle it could be. Either it could also be an impossible way of mentioning that it is not a part of a triangle at all. So, by looking at all these conditions, actions and the entries, we will be able to say that these are the test cases. Say, test cases I have labeled as 1, 2, 3, x, y, z. Say, I mentioned the value of x to be 4, y to be 1 and z to be 2. What is my expected output? This is what I have said to be a sample test case. Even this is also referred to be a black box test case. 1, 4, 2, it is also not a triangle. 1, 2, 4, not a triangle. But then when it is 5, 5, 5, it can be said an equilateral triangle. And when it is left as such as a question, it is impossible. And when it is given with some entries, it can be said it could be isosceles, where x is equal to y is being satisfied, but then x is not equal to z and y is not equal to z. In such a case, it is an isosceles triangle. Likewise, we can proceed further with these set of possible test case derivations. Now, we will have a look at a structural testing. A complementary approach to functional testing is called a structural testing, or otherwise it is called a white box testing. It permits us to examine the internal structure of the program, and if you want to look into the program, examine the code and watch it as it runs. This activity is dynamic and is about to test a running program, and therefore it is called dynamic white box testing. If we want to test the program without running it, meaning thereby examining and reviewing it, then it is the path testing. Before we go for a path testing, we will have a short break. Welcome back after the break. Path testing is the name given to a group of test techniques based on judicially selecting a set of test paths through the program. If the set of test paths is properly chosen, then it means that we have achieved some measure of test thoroughness. This type of testing involves generating a set of paths that will cover every branch in the program, and finding a set of test cases that will execute every path in this set of program paths. So, by clear indication of these two, that is structural testing and path based testing, structural testing would indicate a white box testing where I am supposed to dynamically generate test cases, whereas path based testing, at least one of the paths should be covered. Although in my program, I have various paths to reach to the destination. If I construct a graph, this path based testing gives me a clear understanding of how many paths I may have to traverse. Did I check with every path at least once? So, before we deeply understand on this path-based testing, we'll try to understand what a flow graph means. The control flow of a program can be analyzed using a graphical representation known as flow graph. The flow graph is a directed graph in which nodes are either entire statements or fragments of a statement, and edges represents flow of control. If I and j are nodes in a program graph, there is an edge from node I to j if the statement corresponding to node I can be executed immediately after the statement corresponding to node j. Maybe I will give you a simple representation for this flow graph. It is something like this. A flow graph is normally mentioned like this, where this node represents a single line of statement that I write it as part of my code. And this is the line which is taking us to the next component of code with that we write. Say this could be a void main that we write it on a C program, and after we write a void main, this will take us to a floor parenthesis that is getting opened. Maybe after this we will go for declaration of variables that in turn can be used as another node, and for a printf statement that will be again a node, and for scanf statement that will be again a node. So this becomes the sequence of execution of the program. So by where I am trying to indicate every statement of code that I write in terms of a flow graph. So a flow graph can easily be generated from the code of any problem. This would represent a sequence. This would represent an if then else, it will indicate on this, a while loop, a repeat until loop, and a switch statement. So these are the basic constructs for a flow graph, by where I have indicated circle will represent each line of statement, another circle would represent the next line of statement, and this arrow marked line with an arrow indicates that the program flows from here to the next line. Consider for example this program, where this has been already mentioned for a quadratic equation, where I have given an input as A, B and C with the range 0, 100. So my problem being this, I want to find the roots of this equation. In such a case, this is a simple program which would indicate on the number of lines of code. So after I complete the entire lines of code, I can run and dynamically generate the number of test cases, and I can find the expected output and the actual output also. But then what would happen in terms of converting this as a flow graph? This would be the sample flow graph for the entire program of the quadratic equation. Say I would have got certain sequence of nodes connecting together in a sequence that I have mentioned as A. From A it would have been transferred to B, from B to C, likewise I have got so many graphs. From here we may have to initially find out how many independent paths exist. Independent path is something that takes us from the start to the destination. So how many different ways that I would have connected with moving from 1 to 2. Say for example A, B, C, D, E, H, E, F, G, H, I, J, N, and till this would be one of the paths. Likewise A, B, C, D directly to F, G, H, I, J, to this would be the other path. Likewise, how many independent paths exist in the entire flow graph need to be initially understood. After we have a clear intention of those independent paths, at least with one simple input for every independent path, I may have to test. So that has been the key in understanding in terms of the code that we generate. So this shows us a pure conversion from a flow graph into a sequence of DD graph. Say if sequence 1 to 10 has been converted into A. If you look at the example that I have presented, that would have been actually 1 to 10 in terms of writing the number of lines of code. But then directed graph, I have converted those sequence of 1 to 10 as A, 11 as B, 12 as C, 13 as D and things like that. And further we understand 1 to 10 is called a sequential node, B is supposed to be called a decision node. 11 indicates a decision node, 12 indicates an intermediary node which again could be sequential, 13 indicates again a decision node, 14 and 15 indicates a sequential node, 16 indicates two edges are combined here. Say two activities moving from different direction are getting converged at one location. So these are the understandings which we get as part of the flow graph. And further, for the 39 number of lines of code that I have written, but the directed graph that I have drawn had only S from A to S as the list of activities, and the corresponding remarks for the flow graph that we have drawn, we have mentioned it here. So as part of independent paths, this particular flow graph has got 7 independent paths. Say one of the independent paths being A, B, G, O, Q, R and S. Now that after having understood this concept of independent paths, we may have to switch to finding out the cyclomatic complexity for this graph. The cyclomatic complexity is also known as a structural complexity because it gives an internal view of the code. This approach is used to find the number of independent paths through a program. This provides us the upper bound for the number of tests that must be conducted to ensure that all statements have been executed at least once and every condition have been executed on its true and false side. So the understanding which we get is, for a simple program of 39 number of lines of code, we could generate saying 7 independent paths. Nowadays, every program that we come across or either we write has thousands, either thousands of lines of code or a lakh of lines of code. What is the feasibility of converting those many number of lines of code into a flow graph? Is that really possible? In such cases, after having converted, so many tools are available for converting it. But then after having converted, is there any specific mechanism to identify how many independent paths need to be tested? So for which we have gone for a calculation of cyclomatic complexity, which would indicate us clearly on how many independent paths would be derived out of this particular graph. So MECAB has developed a model which was to find out the cyclomatic metric, which he has mentioned it as V of G, where V is the cyclomat and G is for the graph of the graph G with N vertices, E edges and P connected components, by identifying its formula as vertices of G is equal to E minus N plus 2P, where E represents the number of edges, N represents the number of nodes and P represents predicate node. Now that we will have a simple explanation of this predicate node. Assume this is a node and this has got two branches moving outwards. Now any specific node which has got one or more activity moving out of that particular node, so this node is called a predicate node. You can ask me a question, how about it when two or more edges meet on a single node? In this particular case, this is not considered to be a predicate node, where the circle indicates a node and the arrow mark in the line with an arrow indicates an edge. So in such cases, This is mentioned to be as a predicate note. It is purely because two or more activities move out of this particular node, whereas two or more activities when it converges, this is not supposed to be a predicate node. Summary. In this session, we have looked at decision table based testing, where we have constructed a confusion matrix. That was a part of black box testing. Then we have switched to a structural testing, which was an initiative to white box testing. And we mentioned the importance of converting the code into a flow graph. Further, we were about to initiate with the process of finding out the number of independent paths by use of cyclomatic complexity. Some of the questions for this particular session. Construct a decision table testing for a sample program involving decisions. When do we say the testing to be a dynamic structural testing? What is the need of a flow graph? Thank you.